welcome, dear viewers, to Couch Warrior TV on YouTube. I'm the Couch Warrior, and you are watching The Passage, a Skyrim SE Let's Play featuring Ettien Jorel, the Ultimate Ranger. Well, as you've probably figured out from the cutscenes, we have made our deal with Maven Blackbriar, and now we enter the next phase of our mission. And what exactly is our mission, you may be asking? Well, we made a deal with Maven Blackbriar that included us giving up some valuable insider information about the East Empire Trading Company in exchange for an invitation to a party to be held at the Thalmor Embassy in just a couple of days. This is a big deal, obviously, primarily because it gets us access to the embassy and, by extension, access to Elenwyn, who is the one that I think we really need to deal with in order to try and bring the Thalmor threat to an end. So Ettien is now in a position to start executing on his plan. We have our invitation in hand, and now it's time to start pulling together the pieces that are going to be necessary for us to make this plan a reality. So what's on the agenda? Well, firstly, we have to briefly enter Riften. And we need to make one final visit to the Thieves Guild. And the reason that we're doing this is Ettien needs to turn over to the Thieves Guild, which is basically owned by Maven Blackbriar, the valuable information that he has promised. He needs to hold up his end of the bargain. So he's going to deliver the map, and he is going to deliver what we've agreed to are 4 East Empire Company pendants. All right? So we're going to do that. We'll take one final opportunity to use the fence there to get rid of some stuff, make a little bit of money. And then, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to make a visit to the face sculptor. Even though we have spent the vast majority of Ettien's adventures concealed, our face concealed by the use of a mask, we need to make doubly sure that we're not recognized. And if you'll remember, the very first episode of this Let's Play, the very first episode of The Passage, we started in the Thalmor Embassy, undisguised in any way. So it stands to reason that those people who work in the embassy directly, those people who are guards, people like Elenwyn, would know what Ettien looks like. Now, obviously, it's probably been a long time since they've seen him, but it stands to reason that they would know what Ettien looks like. So we're going to take care of that. A critical part of the plan is to get Ettien inside the embassy safely. So that is going to be a must. And then we're also going to have to take care of some other things. We're going to pull together some of our resources that should help us in this endeavor. It's going to take a significant amount of work and effort to truly neutralize the Thalmor threat in this particular case. So we are going to work toward that end. Welcome back to the story, everybody. We are marching towards the finale. And I think that at this point I have everything sufficiently mapped out so that I can be fairly certain that what we're looking at here is 4 episodes remaining, including the one that you're watching now. So this episode and 3 more, and we will hit the finale episode.
Still have quite a good bit of jobs available, if you're looking for some extra coin.
Look, I've got this East Empire Company map I'm turning over to you. This is for Maven.
Well, well, I was looking for this little beauty. If you happen to cross any other unusual trinkets like this, be sure to bring them to me. I promise it'll be worth the effort. This should compensate you for your fight.
700. Not bad. Let's get rid of this decanter while we're at it as well.
Well, well, I was looking for this little beauty. If you happen to cross any other unusual trinkets like this, be sure to bring them to me. I promise it'll be worth the effort. I think you'll find this payment to be more than fair. Hey, this guild needs the coin. Walking away without taking work is not going to make you popular around here.
I'm not really interested in popularity in the Thieves Guild anymore. This is the last time I'm walking in this place.
If you stick to the rules and you'll end up rich, break them and you're out on your arse. So I give special rates to members of the Thieves Guild. Show me what you've got.
All right. We probably don't have a lot left to sell, but it doesn't hurt to just double check. You never know. Okay, so we've got 5 of these pendants. Ettien is going to keep 1 for himself, and he's going to turn over 4 of them. Okay, got this gold ring we can get rid of. I think the rest of this stuff is stuff we're keeping. Okay, we can get rid of gems. Empty soul gems. Okay. Now potions, you remember we've kind of gone through and pared this down quite a bit. So the stuff that we're carrying is stuff that we really just are pretty sure we need. Invisible for 90 seconds when performing an action that breaks invisibility. Okay, Shroud Walk, that may be a good one to keep, knowing that we're on our way toward what could be extremely challenging infiltration. Forbidden Sun. Let's get rid of that. Get rid of that.
All right, then.
All right. Now we need to talk to this unsavory woman. But first we gotta bare our face because we gotta be able to see what we're changing. I understand you know how to change someone's appearance.
Change it. I can remake your face, if that's what you desire. I do not practice my art for free, however. I doubt you can afford my services. You have the smell of the vagabond about you.
Don't be ignorant.
Very well. Just tell me what you desire. Beauty or hideous deformity. Nothing is beyond my skill.
All right, let's have a look. Now, what we want to do is we want to change Etienne's appearance to something that'll make him look, you know, nice, aristocratic, different enough that getting into the party shouldn't be a problem, but not so much that we're changing him, his look wholesale. So what we're going to do is first the war paint's got to go, and then we're just going to focus on a few critical things. We're not going to change his bone structure in any way. But I think one of the most significant things we could do would be to make a slight change in eye color. Now, if you... His red eyes are very distinctive, and distinctive to everyone he meets, even if he's wearing a face mask. In many cases, the only thing that people see of him that is even recognizable or memorable are his eyes. Because of the way that he's been dressed the course of this whole thing, his eyes are really distinctive. So what we're going to do is let's make a modification here. We're going to go to just green eyes. That's, I think, a significant enough change that that will help considerably to disguise him. And we're not going to mess with the brow or the mouth, and we're going to change the hair. So as far as facial hair goes, we're going to, I think, bring it down a little bit. We're going to darken up the color, and then he's always had his hair in kind of an updo. We're going to do something down a bit more. It'll frame up his face, have the overall effect of, I think, changing sort of the... It'll have the illusion of changing the structure of his face as opposed to having his hair pulled up away from his face. So we'll go with the dark hair, which is the polar opposite of what we had been doing. Okay. Now he's had kind of a goatee thing going on. So we're going to get away from that style. Maybe go with something like this. Just exposing that upper lip. Having no facial hair on the upper lip is going to be a really significant change. I mean, he looks like a different man without, you know, any structural changes to his face. So I think that's a pretty good disguise for our protagonist. And he looks regal. He looks pretty regal, so given the right attire, I think he could fit right in. All right, we've done it. Now, before we do anything else, we got to conceal this change in identity. Only the face sculptor has seen the new look. So now we're back out. And at this point, Ettien sees himself walking away from this life. The life of a thief, it was a means to an end, and nothing more. Now he's walking away from it. Now these are still contacts that he will have in the future, should he need them. And as I've said before, I don't necessarily believe that the end of this story is the end of Etienne's story, as it were. I think we will see more from Ettien possibly in the future. So.
Good morning.
Good morning. Now, with this change, we should also be able to wash our hands of the city of Riften for some time to come. So let's get out of here and then hit the trail.
You and your honeyed words.
Really? Okay, so what are we going to do next? Our next destination is Angie's camp. We need to go there because that's where our allies are. And in order for us to pull this off, we are going to need some help from our allies. We need to get some messages out. We need to get some plans made. We need to put some people and some resources in place in order for any of this to work. So that is our next destination. So maybe this would be a good time for us to talk a little bit about the cutscene you saw. Obviously, when we're doing this kind of a role play, there's certain leaps that we have to make. There really is no, there's no existing mechanic in the game or in the dialogue, especially where Maven is concerned, for us to quote unquote cut the sort of deal with her that we're talking about in this story. And sometimes I will cover these story elements in commentary, and sometimes I will do it as a cutscene. And I balance that depending on what it is I'm trying to do and whether or not I think a commentary-style discussion of that role-play element would be instructive or interesting for us to talk about. And then there are other times when really what I'm trying to do is present you with a dramatic story. So I'm always kind of making those decisions on the fly as I go, trying to determine if what I'm doing at the moment really needs story or commentary. And one of the things that I've determined is interesting or key to what I think of as the couch warrior style is the combination of role play and storytelling. We're done, goon. Okay. Healing, we'll take that. Stamina, we don't really need. Arrows are good. This is something, this is an issue that I've struggled with in the past, right? And so much of what I've been working on over the last couple of years is trying to figure out what the right mix is for me, because I don't want to do just Let's Plays. I want to tell stories. And if I'm telling a story, there are some situations where I want to preserve some mystery. I want to present you with some surprises. I want to be able to have enough mystery in the story that I can have some cliffhangers or some twists and turns or make viewers think about some of these quests in different ways. However, what I've discovered is the deeper that I try and go into that style of storytelling, sometimes the worse off I am, because the only way for me to preserve that degree of mystery is to do tons and tons of cutscenes and essentially allow you to see exactly what I want you to see. And that style of storytelling becomes unsustainable. It's why I couldn't, in the end, it's why I couldn't maintain Five Fables, for example, because there wasn't enough commentary. It was all storytelling. It was all cutscenes. It was all of that, right? And then there's other situations where I'm doing more of a traditional Let's Play, but I'm doing it in character voice, which is like RuneRunner. That is fun, and I enjoy it, and I'm able to make the adventure move quickly, but quite often I find myself painted into a corner where I want to do a particular thing, but the in-game dialogue does not allow me to do so. So I end up having to come up with cutscenes or whatever and try to piece it all together with, you know, complex combinations of mods, custom mods, things like that. That's not sustainable either. So what I've discovered is the perfect combination for me because of this is this combination of a commentary style let's play with focus on story and character voice. Because if I find myself in a sticky spot, we can talk our way through it just like we are now. And if I want to preserve some mystery, I can do it by, you know, light reliance on cutscenes, things like that. It gives me the most flexibility. So in the cutscene here at the beginning of this episode, I was able to sort of communicate the idea of Ettien making his ultimatum to Maven and them engaging in some kind of a negotiation over it. And obviously accomplished that through the use of a couple of cutscenes and a letter. We're out in the open. We got to get to cover. Oh, man, this is not good. Into the trees. Frying pan into the fire, huh? Even with all these trees, I feel like there's still not enough cover. All right, well. So, that's kind of what was going on in the beginning there. Sometimes I feel like it's helpful to explain to you where my brain is at here. And, you know, it doesn't matter how many of these I do. Every single time I do it, I'm learning something new about production, about storytelling, about myself as a player and a storyteller. So I don't feel like there ever is a point where you've kind of got all the answers, you know, you've dialed it all in and everything's, you know, there's always something that can be done better. And the passage is no exception to that. Bandits down here. What I want to do is make my way back toward the road. So, yeah. Even though I've been at it for a long time now.
What was that?
Every time I do it, I'm learning something new. Either, well, there's so much to learn, right? About how to tell stories, about how to record Let's Plays, about how to do production, about what this game has to offer. There's always something new to learn. So there have been a lot of things that I have taken away from the passage, both good and bad. There's another one of our spirit creatures. Sacrifice for kind. We got an archery level, too. All right. We're going to take the pelts and the claws on that one. Treat it as if it were a gift from kind. All right. Trick here is to not lose my bearings. This fog. Pretty sure the road's over that direction. Rather than go directly there, I'm gonna kind of loop around a little bit here. Just so you're aware, also, I have taken the step of increasing the difficulty of the game to legendary. So, at this point, what you're seeing is legendary gameplay for the remainder of the passage. It seemed like a good thing to do, considering how powerful Ettien is now at level 40. And it seemed like kind of a nice capper for the whole story. A nice, I guess, a nice capper in his progression. So, that's what we're going to do. But, because of that, I've got to be much more careful. That bear, for example. I mean, at master difficulty, that bear would have been a one-shot deal. And he wasn't. This time, it was two. That's just because of the increase in difficulty, so... Alright, this brings us back to where we were. There's a... That Imperial camp is over there, and I'm going to try to avoid getting too close to it if I can. So we're going to go up this way. Etienne's really got the fog working in his favor at the moment, which is great. We need whatever advantage we can get. Even at level 40, you can't take anything for granted. And that's one of the things that the difficulty question, we've talked about it a little bit in the past. When I play, I like the difficulty to be fluid. I don't feel the need to play master difficulty all the way through. I'm totally fine with starting a game at adept, for example, and then as the character progresses in levels, increasing the difficulty level as well. Keep the challenge up. So that's usually what I do. A lot of times when I start a new character, I'll start that character at adept and kind of make my way up to legendary. Sometimes I never go to legendary. Sometimes I kind of stop at master. It just depends on the character type and how confident I am playing a character like that. That whole question will be somewhat interesting when we get into the Ashes story, because in that story I'm going to be playing two characters who are basically pure mages. I'm very comfortable playing archers. Ooh, what killed this bear? Very comfortable playing assassins, very comfortable playing warriors at legendary difficulty, but not so comfortable playing mages. So, you guys are going to be in for a treat as you watch me kind of fumble my way through that. If you haven't checked it out yet, I would highly encourage you to go out to the channel and check out the Ashes production preview video that I put out last week. I made some announcements there, and I'll just repeat those now. You all, if you're watching this episode, likely it means that you've watched the majority of the episodes that have come before, and I can't begin to tell you how much I appreciate your viewership. And so whenever I come up with a new idea or a plan or, you know, have answers to some questions that I think you guys might enjoy hearing about, I'm always happy to clue you guys in on new things that are coming. I feel like those of you who are such dedicated viewers sort of deserve to get that information first. So, let's get our cloak on, shall we? It's a fancy one. So what I've elected to do is, for Ashes, our primary protagonist is going to be Marl. And Marl is a Dunmer. He is a pure mage, focused primarily on conjuration. And he will be starting at low level. Not first level, I think he's probably going to be starting at third level. It took me up to third level just to kind of get him set up the way that I wanted to for the start of the story. So he'll be, we'll be seeing kind of our low level character progression with Marl as he adventures and grows as a person and grows in his power. But we are also going to have a second character, and they're going to be kind of running on parallel storylines, if you will. And that character is called the Shadeling. The Shadeling is also a pure mage, focused on illusion and destruction. And that is a character we'll be seeing high-level play from, and the stories will cross over. Now, the Shadeling storylines are going to be produced first and foremost for Patreon supporters. So Ashes will kind of have two parallel tracks going on, Marl's story and Shadeling's story. And the Shadeling story will be produced and then distributed to Patreon supporters first. And so if you're interested in watching the Shadeling and that portion of the Ashes storyline, I highly encourage you to support Couch Warrior TV and Character Crusade podcast on Patreon. So as I record those will be distributed links in a private email to all Patreon supporters. They'll be able to watch those. They will eventually be released to the public, but not immediately. So it's important for you to understand that. The stories will cross over. I'm going to try as much as I can to not have the stories interdependent in such a way that you won't get the full story or you won't understand Marl's story if you don't get that content. I don't want to create confusion, but I do want to create something special for those of you who have elected to support Couch Warrior TV on Patreon and been so generous. I just really appreciate it very, very much. What do we got here? We're Thalmor, right? We just blasted past them before, but we need to get a better look. Yeah. And they've got a prisoner. Mage first. God, I really don't want to hit their prisoner. Hitting. All right. It's an absolute miracle that we didn't hit them with that many shots, but still preserved our stealth. So let's stalk them for a ways and see what they do. Ettien is feeling compelled to release that prisoner. Although we are in bad shape. I mean, we need rest, we need food. See if we can get a better view. They're moving pretty quick. Oh, perfect. Look at that. Mage. He's right in there, though. Got the mage. Got him. Always happy to eliminate a justiciar. So what are they going to do? Regroup? Trees are so thick. All right. Let's make them change position, come to us. Again, things are a little bit more difficult now at legendary, and I don't know what's the deal, but I'm feeling a little bit off today. Like, gonna come back. Whoa. Just go. And good for you. Take some loot. Okay. Let's have a look at this other body over here. Gave me a little bit of a hard time, but it's still, I mean, got the job done. That's one thing I will say about just raising the difficulty through the game itself. I mean, in the end, it just ends up being you need more arrows. You know? What used to take you one arrow now takes two or three. That kind of thing. Which is brain dead in some ways, right? So glad we were able to take out that mage without hitting the prisoner. I was a little concerned that that scrum was so tight, it was hard to tell who was who. Fortunately for us, the justiciar gave himself away. Because of the armor spell he was using on himself. So, that worked to our advantage, I guess. Does he stay down? Let's make our way through here. Obviously, this isn't the only way to Angie's camp. We've got a back way that we've gone a few times, but this works as well. Ooh.
That's it?
Bow punch.
That's your best? Why is there? You'll pay for that?
Who else? Anybody else? Alright. Definitely feeling the effects of the lack of sleep and all that stuff too in the combat here. I mean, I'm sure that's a big part of it. That combined with the increase in difficulty is a struggle to say the least. So let's not take any chances. Stealth is good enough, we probably could have pulled that off without having to use the spell, but at this point, in his condition, I just wasn't willing to take any chances. Ettien is feeling the pressure right now. He's feeling the pressure of time. Okay, we've got a party that's coming up. In order to maximize our chance of success in pulling this off, we have to get certain key pieces in place. Well, dear viewers, thank you for joining me on yet another adventure of the passage. I will see you next time.